Welcome to yet another webinar from the All India Ophthalmic Society. And today's topic on the event of World Sight Day, that is 14th November, is very apt, that is recent advances in the management of diabetic retinopathy by none other than Professor Atul Kumar, who is the chief of the Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And today we are live from the Lecture Theatre 6, RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, AIIMS, New Delhi, with all our residents and faculty, and we are thankful to all of them for being here. And it is a privilege and honor to introduce the speaker who needs completely no introduction at all, Professor Atul Kumar, Chief of RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, who was awarded Padma Shri in January 2007 by the President of India. He was appointed as the Honorary Advisor of Ophthalmology to the Government of India since 2016 and is also the Honorary Consultant to Armed Forces Medical Services. He has a list of numerous awards, to name a few, the BMA Best Medical Teacher Award by the Delhi Medical Association, the coveted National Hari Om Ashram Trust Award by UGC, and he was also awarded the FRCS Edinburgh by Royal College of Surgeons in 2017. And above all, he's the teacher of teachers, and today he would be talking to us. And we have amongst the panelists Dr. Anand Rajendran and Dr. Sarita Berry, who would be introduced by the treasurer, Dr. Rajesh Sinha of AIOS.
On this World Diabetes Day, we have this webinar wherein we have two eminent retina specialists as the panelists. We have Dr. Anand Rajendran, who is the Chairman of Scientific Committee, Chairman Scientific Committee of Vitreoretinal Society of India. He graduated in medicine from Jipmer, Pondicherry, and then did DO and DNB from Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai. He has been awarded an honorary FRCS. Currently, he is the Chief of Vitreoretinal Services at Arvind Eye Hospital, Chennai. He has published several research papers in peer-reviewed international journals and state journals. He has been invited speaker in various conferences and a very well-known retina specialist. We welcome you, Dr. Anand. Then we have another very eminent retina specialist from Delhi, from Lady Harding Medical College, New Delhi, Professor Sarita Berry. She is the head of the department at Lady Harding Medical College, New Delhi. And she is again a very sought after retina specialist in most of the conferences. She has various publications in various journals. She completed her MBBS from TMC Ludhiana and joined RP Center AIIMS, New Delhi for post graduation. And she, after doing that, she became a faculty at Lady Harding Medical College. And she has many research publications to her credit. We welcome both of you in this webinar.
So, over to Professor Atul Kumar for his talk on recent advances in the management of diabetic retinopathy.
Good afternoon, everybody, AIOS members, colleagues, friends, juniors, and the postgraduates all over the country, as well as the postgraduate residents from RP Center who are here. And I'm grateful to the AIOS and to the Secretary, Dr. Ramta Sharma, and to the Treasurer, Dr. Rajesh Sinha, in particular, for having invited me to deliver this diabetic retinopathy talk on this very important day, which is the World Diabetes Day. It's celebrated all over the world as the 14th November. Every year is always the Diabetic Retinopathy Day, irrespective of the day of the week. But so you have to understand and know that the importance of diabetes by itself is very important, that we have to exercise, we've got to have a certain calorie diet, we've also got to make sure that we don't we get ourselves tested. So all these things are important, and diabetes unfortunately affects the eye in a very big way. So we are on this World Diabetic Day, AIOS is dedicating this lecture to the World Diabetes Day by delivering, asking me to, and also Dr. Anand Rajendran will also speak after me, to speak on diabetic retinopathy, which is the disease of diabetes and affects the eye with irreversible blindness often. So I started any more delay, I started this talk, and I just want to tell you that I'll be talking about the recent advances, the present day modality of treatment, nothing historical, and what we are heading towards. I'm not going to into futuristic what's going to happen, but I'm going to tell you today and tomorrow of diabetic retinopathy management with the latest possible innovations which are there, the imaging innovations, the treatment innovations, everything which is there. I can talk to you about. If I miss anything, we'll have our panelists to cover it up. So WHO and India have both estimated that diabetes is going to be, there will be a major increase. Especially in India, we happen to be called the diabetes capital, but we have a major increase of diabetic retinopathy to about 70 to 80 million. In fact, they say this may be even higher by the year 2025, which is hardly 5-6 years from now. So what I should like to tell you is that global estimate of diabetes shows that about 8.2 million in diabetics in 2017, and this will jump up to 150 million and in the year 2045. So this is going to be a very high score. And you can see 2045, we're going to have the world diabetics will be 6.9 million at an approximate estimate. And 2017, it'll be about 4.5. So there's an ever increase in the world, but you can see the red shows is a massive increase over here in the North, Southeast Asia, which actually India plays a major role in this occurrence of this incidence going up. So the epidemiology of DR is what is important for us for our own country. So in our own country till 2015, there have been numerous studies, and they've all shown that mild DR was the most common and prevalence was 11.8, whereas only 7% participants had some form of diabetic macrophagy, which was low. That was before or till 2015. The prevalence of side affecting DR, which was also called VTDR, was found to be 3.6% only. That is pre-proliferative or severe MPDR or PDR. These are the side threatening DRs. Of course, DME is also there, but usually we get to treat it and it's part of the site testing. WHO said that about in India, the number of diabetics they said was 72.19 million. That's what they said until 2015. Now, it's been estimated in 2015 that the total overall blindness only 1.06 and blindness and less than 3 by 60. And from 618 to 3 by 60 was only 1.16. To see these figures is very low. To see that diabetic retinopathy by itself is a very low incidence. But are these actually the figures? These are actually not the figures. So RP Center, along by the National Program for Control of Blindness, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India requested, and we did a survey from 2015 to 19, and this survey has been released by the Minister of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, as a National Diabetic Retinopathy Survey. And this summary of this survey report is there in this table. This shows that the prevalence of DR actually is about 16.9%. Not those 1 point figures, you know. It's 16.9%. Nearly a crore of population or more are suffering from some form of DR. We are doing a survey in this month, and you'll be surprised to know every day we are picking up unknown DR, at least 5 patients. Unknown DR who don't know that they have any eye infection, only because they are diabetic, we got them screened in this month, and we are still continuing the screening. So it's shocking the way the results are coming out in tertiary centers, and the prevalence was in a national survey is 16.9%, which is very, very high. So of course, the types of DR which they have is there for you to know, but you can also, we can WhatsApp you this, I think I WhatsApped you to this, you've already put it on the various groups. This survey was a RAB survey and it was done over 50 years and conducted by RP Center. And this was what they found. So you've got to understand diabetic retinopathy in a simpler form is mild, moderate, severe, and proliferative diabetic retinopathy when new vessels develop. And at the juncture of non-proliferative and PDR, in between lies DME. DME is nothing separate. If somebody says, a company said that we speak only on DME, that's not makes sense. So you see, DR has to be spoken of as a whole. DR includes DME. or DME is a part and parcel of DR. You can't have pure DME, very rare. You will have changes of diabetic retinopathy elsewhere. Any change of diabetic retinopathy elsewhere which is not associated with fluid or exudates in the macula is DR. Whether it's MPDR or PDR, you can have both with DME. So that's very important to understand. It's not a separate thing. You can call it in the subdivision, but it's always mild, moderate, severe MPDR and PDR. The VTDR is vision-threatening DR, is severe MPDR and PDR. So this is a patient seen just hardly 2 weeks back by us with a wide field system, and you can see the amount of torrid neovascularization growing outward from the disc. This patient had a very pale look when he came to us. He's never been sent by a physician to a diabetic to a ophthalmologist. Every ophthalmologist is capable of diluting the pupil and having a look at the retina, and you can always refer it for for a specific management to a retina specialist. But any ophthalmologist could do that, and it's so important for the physician and the endocrinologist to maintain a customer liaison, and they should also refer to the nephrologist. They should also refer to the neuropathy. Sometimes we find that a patient is wearing a shoe. He may not tell you, but we've had patients where they've had a gangrenous foot. So gangrenous foot is often there. They may have very severe neuropathy. So don't see a diabetic retinopathy just by seeing the retinopathy. I would advise you also get his endocrinological checkup. If he has evidence to show increased urea creatinine, get his nephro checkup must. Really having a KDM2 syndrome, or he'll be having chronic kidney disease. Then he needs urgent nephro consultation, because his retinopathy edema will keep on increasing until you treat the nephropathy. Same thing with the neuropathy. And also they have silent cardiac issues. Most of them have hypertension. So it's very rare to get a patient with a severe MPDR or PDR, especially PDR, without hypertension. It's very rare. Many of them actually have very good diabetes control, but we have very poor or out of control hypertension. If I'm telling you what we actually see over years of experience, that this happens and this has to be treated. If you control hypertension, the COD study says it, the UKPDS shows it, every study, many of the studies have shown. HT control helps in reduction in the progression of DR. So it's very important that the patient takes the proper antihypertensive medication. So then the pathophysiology is such that you can have inflammation and diabetes which are going on. The diabetes causes some clinical inflammation. There's a microvascular damage due to the inflammation. There is also ischemia. There's a inner blood retinal barrier breakdown, no doubt. Inner breakdown, and these are the arterioles and these are the venules. In between are the capillaries, and they get occluded at the precapillary arteriole junction. The precapillary arteriole junction gets occluded, but the RBCs get rigid. It's called roulet formation. There is increased thickening of the capillary lumen, and there is increased adhesiveness of the platelets. All this many of the people would know in the AIOS, but it's important to know at this stage the pericyte are the supporting cells of the capillary. And these supporting cells maintain the structure and the functional integrity of the capillary. What happens is when the sorbitol active pathway gets activated, there is, due to the aldose reductase enzyme, there is increased production of sorbitol. And sorbitol accumulates in the pericyte and causes osmotic stress. And loss of pericyte is one of the harbingers of DR, clinical DR. And when you get clinical DR, you will get outflow change, you will get exudation into the extracellular compartment. The extracellular compartment exudation leads to diabetic macular edema. And the outpouching lead to microorganisms, which are the earliest changes as per the clinical changes in DR. So these are preclinical changes or the biochemical changes which are occurring at the capillary level. This is a microangiopathy. So you get macular edema, you get neovascularization, you go hand in hand. And that just increases because there is ischemia. This is a patient who's got, this is a disc, this is a macula, and his ischemia is right here. So the ischemia is so close to the macula, not close to the angiogram. You can imagine the amount of VEGF is releasing. And the VEGF release by itself deranges the capillary, the inner blood retinal barrier, and you can get, functionally, you will get DME. So risk factors are already known to many of you, and I think the slide is projected to most of the, to all the people in the AIOS who are watching it. The duration is very important, something which you can't affect. But the control is something which we can do, something for the diabetes. Once we control diabetes, we also control the DR. We also take care of the hypertension. Of course, during pregnancy, we have to be careful. the insulin and all has to be given in the proper doses, especially in the first trimester. If at all, anti-VEGF is not to be given, fluorescein is not to be done, and you can do a octa, you can do a OCT, you can deliver laser therapy. I have patients, but we've never given laser, or waited till the pregnancy is over. The laser can work quite well. If there's nephropathy that has to be taken care of, we have to, often our patients go from endocrinology to cardiology and sometimes nephrology. So they have to go around. This is the only way. This is the only route. Already we told you about the importance of hyperlipidemia. Emily Chu is the director of the Retina Institute and recently got the, she delivered the famous oration, Jackson, the memorial oration at the American Academy, said that hyperlipidemia has a major role. Major role in hyperlipidemia. She's been talking about this for the last many years. And she said as an authority that the lipid levels which are drained, the court also said it, that you have to control with phenofibrates preferably, otherwise you can even use other drugs, but like statin group of drugs, simvastatin, tolvastatin, you've done work here, published data, there's the published data for PGIOS, and control by itself can regress the retinopathy, that's also been there. Smoking, of course, is part of everything, and also for DR. So imaging will come out right away, and we'll tell you that there is a gold standard called fluorescein angiography. Slowly, this gold standard may become silver standard. Because this thing has been age old. But the problem is that now, interesting is that the OCT and the OCT are coming up as very useful, complementary, non-invasive tests. Nobody wants an invasive test if he's got an option of a non-invasive test. Everybody likes non-invasive procedures. When somebody wants to put a needle in the eye, even then the people get frightened out of their skin. They don't like needles in their eye. But sometimes it's unavoidable. But if you can tell him, go control our diabetes, it may help his retinopathy to go down to such a level that the number of injections given up may be half. We don't have figures on that. We have to do the RCT. Control diabetic, number of injections. Uncontrolled diabetic, number of injections. Control diabetic means control HT, control diabetes, control lipid, control cardiac status, or hypertension is a cardiologist checkup. Hypertension is the cardiologist to come in the domain. So according to me, a hypertension control, especially in diabetes, has to go to a cardiologist. So it has to be to the, like our place, we go straight to the center of neurosciences and cardiology here, the cardiac neurosciences center. So it's everywhere, all over India, all the ophthalmologists in AIOS have access to cardiology centers and they must refer all the patients. And sometimes I find the cardiologists are very good at even controlling the diabetes. So it's their messages, by the way, the MD, so MDDM. So any kind of diabetes, you should, you know, this OCT is a very good that's non-invasive. So this is an invasive something I never used to say before, that this a dye injection is done, patient has a lot of glare, there's a fundus photograph camera, the pupils are fully dilated, and there's a flash lamp. And the patient gets total, he gets a bleaching of the dye and he squeezes his eye. He's very uncomfortable during photo sit lamp pictures of the fundus. So this is what happens when you take these pictures. With these pictures, of course, you have to take within 1 second of each other. There's no way. Unlike opta, which can take as and when required without injection. So what's the preference? Automatically, it comes if the octa is of equal resolution except for the edema, which the OCT will pick up, I'd rather do the octa. So, this is what we will pick up, and at times these margins get obscured because the dye very quickly excavates. Because the blood retinal barrier is broken out of a dry excavate, of course, it tells you that there is a leakage, but the microvascular abnormalities are not known. And even the phase cannot be measured. Can you clearly tell me where the phase is, how large the phase is? At this picture is very different. Very difficult to approximate idea with a fluorescein angiography. It's good for doing research studies, level 4 evidence between focal and diffuse edema because very useful. But now the imaging has improved from the classical 30 to 50 degree cameras which are still available and are very useful with the montage, it can work wonders. But the thing is that you can maximum get is a 75 degree field. The non-contact module of the Heidelberg is 102. Now, there's a recent article in the latest ophthalmology journal, Ophthalmology Retina, maybe an issue before. At the Academy time, there was one issue released which shows the latest grading for widescreen systems for any kind of diabetes or any kind of retinopathy. They say 100 degrees or anterior limit of the vortex ampulla. That's widescreen limit. Anything which reaches the vortex ampulla anterior border, that is widescreen limit. The classical 30 degrees and 50 degrees hardly give you fundus and disc. Or you can go around, but you won't get till the vortex ampulla. Vortex ampulla you only get with the Heidelberg system, which is 102 degrees. That is widescreen. When you go into this region, the depths of the ocean, this is when you go into widefield imaging, ultra widefield imaging. Ultra widefield imaging is 200 degrees on the optical imaging system, or there is a lens which is not very much light because it's a contact lens. You have to put viscoelastic, then tachycardia, viscoelastic, and then put it on the eye, 150 degrees. So basically, what you're left with is non-contact optical, which is the ultra widefield beyond the ampulla of the equator, right from the center, fovea, disc, all the way to the near the aura, not reaching to the aura. But if you move the eye, ask the patient to move the eye, you can reach to the aura. So this is what is the system, this is called the Ophthalmic California version. You can see the entire retina. It performs not only fluorescein, it performs fast autofluorescein imaging, color pictures as about fluorescein ICD, all four. 200 degree pictures, 82% of the retina covered. You move the eye, you get more. It's a confocal SLO based system, so no flash, no bright light, just like spectralis or the Heidelberg system, unlike the flash based system, digital system. It has a laser light, as a result of which patient does not see any flash, and the resolution is very high. It's got a refract mirror, which is a slight drawback, and you get pictures of the temporal and nasal quadrant much better than the superior and inferior. So this is a widescreen picture, but we will kind of cropped it because to fit it onto one slide is nowadays the biggest problem for me. Because there's so much of imaging pictures that we can't fit it onto one slide. If we don't fit it onto one slide, you can't show what you want to show. But too many slides on a same patient doesn't help. So we have a lot of soft exudates, and he's got PD, look like he has severe NPDR and all that, but closing here, he basically had, first time he came to us and he had a creatine A1C or 9.2, creatine 6.2, all deranged. CKD with uncontrolled diabetic, no prior laser, premature PDR. So he's got this block fluorescence and he's got severe CNT areas. Of course, the fluorescein picks up the images very nicely and some new vessels starting to develop here. Some new vessels may be starting to develop here, always at the area of the exterior. And here also some new vessels are there which probably bled and causes bleeding. So this is the white field, this is another white field. You cropped it, you can see even with the wide field, you can zoom up and take a very magnified view of the fovea and the macula at the disc. And you can see new vessels. This is not the FA. This is Octa, OCTA. So what we did was, the patient was an uncontrolled diabetic and CKD. So in the CKD patient, we got the Octa and we found the new vessels and the ischemia. So based on this, we did the laser. Okay. And we also found there was a patient had drill, I'll tell you about that, and there's cystic edema, so we can give anti-VEGF followed by laser. So we don't need the fluorescein. The gold standard we have slowly is coming to silver, soon may come to bronze. So depends what happens in the future. So the utility of ultra-wide field intraocular is that you can see the peripheral USLs with guide to targeted laser photocognition. That means don't laser healthy retina, laser only unhealthy retina. And this is a patient where there was actually hypertensive retinopathy with severe chronic kidney disease. You can see the macular scar and the disc edema and the hemorrhages all over. This looks like very severe DR. This is hypertensive retinopathy like grade 4 with macular edema, severe agitation into the retina. The patient may go into a stroke any moment. These kind of patients even have swinging between life and death. So they want to get an urgent. If you see the streptococcity right at the disc, this is a disc, he's got edema at the edge of the disc. This is because of the fluid collection due to the papular edema. And he's got severe hypertensive retinopathy. He's urgent, nephro, cardio, probably get admitted in cardiology. The HTR, get his blood pressure under control, prevent the stroke, just put an anticoagulant and he'll need a nephro consultation and he'll need a diabetic consultation subsequently. So it tells you much more. So OCT angiography from the wide field imaging have come to OCT angiography. Doctor FA, we talked about wide field FA, we talked about OCT already a little bit. But most important thing is this is non-invasive test, the motion of RBC is a sinus contrast. We can get a segmentation analysis. So the various algorithms are there. There is a SSODA, SSDA, which is there, and this is a decorrelation algorithm. And there is an Octara, which is used for the fructose OCT. So this is a picture of a FA. The protein shows new vessels here, and so probably a loop, but could be a new vessel. And not a new vessel, okay? The CT showed us new vessels here. Same as this, okay, and we see the loop also. So most of the things the clinical picture already shows us. Now what does the octa show us in this picture? It shows the new vessels very clearly wherever they are present. All these arborescent irregular vessels which are not following the dichotomous branching are all new vessels. You see they are showing us the new vessels, they are also showing us the ischemic areas. And the loop is very clearly identified. Even the new vessel is reaching to the edge of the arcade. So what I'm trying to say is that there is equal knowledge gained. It's not going to give me less. And this is the expense of without injecting dye. And also, probably the new vessels are seen so clearly. I'll show it to you in a later picture. So it picks up the microvascular abnormality very well. And all this new vascularization is ischemia extreme, where the leakage doesn't come in, but that the OCT will tell you. This is one patient which we followed up. Can OCTA replace FSA as a non-invasive modality for DR? My answer today is, which is subject to a lot of arguments in the AIOS, which again, I'm ready to answer any time, any day, whenever the AIOS permits me. But my answer is that this is the fluorescein, this is the opta of the patient, same. Huge new vascular membrane from the disc. This is a 12 million to 20 meter opta scan, because the fields are limited. And this we lasered it. You see the difference between this and this. It's regressed to some extent. This we can't make out in a fluorescein. The individual vessels can be seen to have regressed backwards. All this area which was so florid has all gone backwards. In fact, some vessels have started becoming visible. So probably if we do a little more laser or wait for a little more time or add a little more pencil laser, all this new vessel may regress even further. It's a very satisfying feeling that the opta is giving us so much information. So it's got advantages, no use of dyeing. It can be done with CKD, separate assessment retina choroid because it's segmentation. So you can do superficial capillary level, deep capillary level, the avascular level, then you can go to the RP level, you can go to some RP. You can grade the new vascularization, type 1, type 2, type 3. Very sub-RP, PRP, or intraretinal. And you can also make out where the adaptive retinopathy, because we're not discussing RMD or other new vascularization, we just saw adaptive retinopathy, the adaptive world adaptive race, so I'll tell you, those pictures are self-explanatory. Artifacts are there. I'm now coming from this to something which is very important, present day and today and tomorrow of ophthalmology or adaptive retinopathy is the OCT biomarkers. Macular thickness and desert levels, hyperreflective foci, the drill, which is a disorganization of the inner retinal layers, which I've told you again and again, but I think it's more for the residents they have been told. But for the AIOS, I think it's very important that they should know that drill has to be seen on the OCT. Progression of the disease, ellipsoid zone or the IFOS junction gets disrupted, and iron knuckle thickening associated with because of neurodegeneration. It's not only fluid. It's not only capillary microangiopathy, it's a neurodegenerative disease also. So that's why people have brimonidine implants and all. People are talking about it. So these changes may even proceed. So the patient has no segmentation. You can't segment the layers, or inner layers of the retina into various layers. There's no segmentation. It's a featureless scan. Featureless scan, absolutely. This is drill. And you may have associated findings of some ERM and all may be there, that's besides the point. But drill is basically disorganized, this is central 1 millimeter zone. Okay? And then you can get outer retinal tribulation. This is ORT. Outer retinal tribulation is a sign of neurodegeneration. These are probably some photoreceptor, dead photoreceptors, which are lying there as some garbage. These are dead photoreceptor debris. It formed this hyper-reflective margin, and there's a hyper-reflective interior. So this is a kind of neurodegenerative photoreceptor damage, a biomarker. Very important. We see it so often. Daily in my OPD, I pick up one or two ORTs and drill also. And we pick up two, three things. Now all the residents are also busy picking up. So this is another patient. Recently only we got it. TDR patient, 636, severe MPDR. So we did his protein more from the point of view of comparing it. So we got these microvascular changes, a venous loop here, a venous loop there. Not probably yet in going into PDR, but here also we got a lot of ischemia and we got a venous loop here, okay? And we got some new vascular changes coming up here. So probably some patients I feel that some of the deeper capillary level changes are picked up more better here than probably the SA. And you can see the ORT, small ORT over here. There's a total drill. You can't featureless. You can't make out anything in the retina. You can't say it's a retinal tissue. You can just say it's something. It's not retinal tissue, it's not segmented. So all these changes are very, everything happens effective foci. All the biomarkers are present in this patient. Overall outcome will not be so good, but the patient needs to urgently, effectively treat his diabetes as well as we need to treat his DR. Not with anti-agents alone, we have to do a lot of other things. So only anti-agents is not the answer for DR. This I've skipped mostly because I think center and non-central vomiting, I think Dr. Anand will speak on this. So this is just a pickup, picked up last week for a patient who has severe DME. This is his OCT or the strep throat. So we are using mostly strep throat at RP center and we found this very severe edema. So we got the thickness map done at the AIOS junction. We have the facility. So we got thickness map done and showed the retina was totally absent, and very degenerated retina. There's hardly any tissue left. And the pseudo-color picture showed the absent ellipsoid zone. AIOS is an ellipsoid zone. The ellipsoid zone was totally absent. So his pars was also enlarged. So not only the pars enlargement is not only the pars, it also means many layers are absent, maybe. So we just found out the ellipsoid was totally absent. Ellipsoid is one of the most important layers from the point of view of visual acuity. So that's a major finding which I thought I'll put it in the slide and bring it to you this last week. So these are the biochemical mechanisms which are there in DME, which also I think Anand will cover. TKC beta activation, increase the VEGF, sorbitol accumulation already there. And this I just want to tell you the dolostuzumab has come in. Besides the other three, it's a humanized single chain, not double chain. Not a fat fragment double chain, it's a single chain fat fragment. 26 kilo daltons, unlike the 48 kilo daltons of ranibizumab and 148 kilo daltons of bevacizumab. Okay, it's now FDA approved, not for DR. It's pronounced something like DVU. FDA just recently approved it in 2019, maybe a couple of months back. So I'm telling you today and the future, today and tomorrow of retina, this is now approved. Soon it will be approved for DR and DME, maybe for DME because usually anti-VEGFs are only for DME. So the rest of the DR you have to do other things. So this is a patient who received anti-VEGF. So what we are telling you that the history of DME goes back to laser, intravitreal steroids, transilone, 2005-10, 2015, we came to bevacizumab. So this is a laser. This is a very important non-center vomiting DME. You can do laser. Anti-VEGF, the options are there. And this is a preferred modality is anti-VEGF. Everybody knows anti-VEGF, so there's no need to go into this. We already know there's a Avastin, which is cheaper. And there's a, it's by a company, but nobody tries to kind of commercially advocate it. So, but it's quite effective. So anti-VEGF regimens can be fixed dose, PRN, protein, and NATA as and when required or treated extend. The retail study, which is a very important study for diabetic retinopathy, used the treat and extend of ranibizumab, which is called inferior. And DRCR.net, which is the latest study. For diabetic retinopathy, the studies which we read nowadays are the DRC adult net studies, the Hawk Harrier, of course, but the other studies mostly DR under the DRC adult net and the use PR and dosing. So, interestingly, the DRC has been when required. You can switch anti-VEGF for getting better improvement. So, are you covering this? Protocol I. So, protocol I is basically the laser versus ranibizumab plus laser, ranibizumab deferred laser within 1 week, within six months, and transformed with laser. What they found out at 5 years was the deferred laser with ranibizumab was the best. So they found that basically ranibizumab with deferred laser. So we protocol T was basically comparing all three. All three were found to be very useful. The details, Anand will tell you. But they found that the vision was very good. It was found that the ranibizumab was as good as the aflibercept. It is better than 6/12. The vision was 6/18 or worse, it was found that aflibercept was best. Right now, we don't have data for ranibizumab, but soon it should be there. Protocol S is basically for PDR. They wanted to compare laser with ranibizumab. They found at 2 years, the ranibizumab was non-inferior to PRP. And they said the benefit was less, vision field loss, low rates of detection. But they don't forget, these patients have to come back for follow-up. And the ischemia kept on increasing. So you can't purely do anti-VEGF. So this is a patient where we have PDR untreated, but we've done given anti-VEGF 3, but then we did laser also. So combining anti-VEGF modified protocol S, protocol U is basically steroids versus steroids and ranibizumab. Here they showed that this is entry level. They gave patients who are resistant to DME and at 12 weeks. Ranibizumab pure versus dexamethasone and ranibizumab. So they added dexa as a osrodex implant, combined the two versus that. So they found that the visual gain was the same, so no advantage of adding dexa. And but the structural outcomes showed drying was more with the combination. This is a control that you, of course, control of that is very important. Imaging has to be very good. So this is a patient who didn't kind of improve. We get a lot of recalcitrant DME. Residents right now posted their see that we often ship them to osmodex, steroid implant. So artificial intelligence and diabetic retinopathy is very important that it's going to truly transform medicine and artificial intelligence, especially diabetes. So there's an IDX-DR software which FDA has approved. It's got an artificial intelligence algorithm to analyze fundus images, to see the fundus images, feed. We have huge memory of pictures of all kinds of DR. Okay, and the artificial this IDX DR software found out the DR correctly identified 7.54% times while board certified ophthalmology using the indirect ophthalmoscope did it only 33.70%. The market is not ophthalmology. You can do it. It is for the primary care endocrinologist who doesn't know what is DR and when to refer. The market is the endocrinologist, the primary care physician, the simple MBBS doctor just from still, or the MD doctor who doesn't know whom to refer. This software, which may be expensive, he needs to keep it. So he can refer cases. So probably it's nothing to worry. It may increase your ophthalmic workload because you refer more patients. It's not for the ophthalmologist. But what will the ophthalmologist do? He already knows. The AI artificial intelligence has a limited value for me as far as I think right now. It's more of hype. Which has been created by Google and all. But I may be wrong. I'm telling you very frankly. I still may be wrong, but I'm telling you what I've read and I go through quite a bit. I'm quite interested in these things. It's a drawback. It's not a drawback. It's got DR and some other changes. How could it be? It's not going to pick it up. I'll tell you DR is my order here. Agar Vishal is mein, sorry. If anybody has hypertensive retinopathy, it will not pick it up. If he's got a macular hole, if he's got AMD, it will not pick it up. So that's a big drawback. So I feel nothing can surpass the human intelligence. Artificial intelligence is an additive tool that can add to the general physician's armamentarium if he wants one. Otherwise, he can also do it. And so I don't know how long this cycle will stay. You've got very good vision. Then you can, if you have very good vision, 6/9 or better, then observe. This is a protocol 5, protocol V. And this is the panorama study, which frankly speaking, I'm not being able to digest it. It says to give aflibercept in moderate to severe NPDR. That means less than PDR or no DME. Moderate to severe, they're coming downwards to the beginning when the patient gets diabetes, they'll say give aflibercept. That's not the answer. So moderate to severe, you will rather control the diabetes and probably add in a little mild scatter in a severe NPDR patient, depending on the OCTA. And if there is no DME, which may not, then you don't need to give antivirus. No DME, no antivirus. So, I don't know, the study is there. Panorama study, you can see it. So this is cataract and DR, which would interest Ajay Secretary and Cesar a lot. But DR and cataract is a very interesting topic because we get a lot of patients. One was this patient who came to us with a total, full, mature, a little hypermature DR, and he's got diabetic retinopathy of L1. So probably we expect him to have DR in this area. We have to take precautions. We have to consider preoperative OCT in all cataract patients as far as the media permits. And also categorize the DME properly. You should not delay the DME treatment after the cataract surgery. Before the surgery, give the antivirus a week before. Some people like to give the antivirus on the table. That's all right. Both are fine. A week before, 10 days before, because the action of the antivirus is maximum 10 to 14 days. So even the DR kind of suppresses. This PDR is suppressed. Just like protocol S. So PDR will get less angry by giving antivirus. So you have less chances of the progression of retinopathy. Whenever you have retinopathy, it's better to operate early cataract, do early cataract. These patients, the cataract should be done even at NS1. Because the thing is, they don't develop very severe DR to lead to vitreous hemorrhage. They won't develop TRD. The third, we can treat. OCTA is not possible in hazy media. And now neither is laser possible in hazy media. So hence, there is a multifactorial reason for giving early cataract surgery. Don't wait for the classical teaching of NS2 and DR eyes. This is something different from what is being taught. And of course, use NSAIDs and of course, steroid drops. Don't manipulate. Have a very neat, clean in the back IOL. And of course, that's an advanced retinopathy. If they're there, as when the lens is clearer, do very fast and aggressive DR laser. Laser is a very finite therapy. Nowadays, you don't find laser symposium. Now, Anand is different. He's going to talk about buccal symposium. So I'll request him to have a laser symposium also. Because everything is hovering around anti-laser. So we have to move out a company who sells anti-laser from this symposium because they wanted it in their way. We are not going to do it their way. They're going to do our way. Our way also includes laser. Okay? So our way is that you got to treat it advanced retinopathy with laser before surgery at least 3 months. Start treating. There's the periphery. Don't think the periphery has no value. Periphery has a lot of value. In fact, people say don't laser too much posterior to the equator or at the equator. That leads to visual field loss, nyctalopia, color vision problems, accommodation, of course. But these problems of especially night vision are very severe. If you do very anterior laser near the aura, it's equally helpful. Many of the CNP areas you see on optos or wide field imaging are universals are lying at the aura. So that concept about DR being just in the equator is gone. It's absolutely gone. The aura, DR affects till aura. And we have seen it. So that's very important that you have to treat the DR carefully. Now finally the surgical image before I conclude that we are now doing the ingenuity 3D heads up surgery. And this is the advantages that you can, the screen is there. So we have shifted 100% to 3D surgery. We have the IOCT guided with the surgery. This is just a video taken clip of a patient who's getting a macular hole. So just to show you that a screen is there and everybody can watch and the IOCT guidance really helps. This is a preoperative patient of PDR and this is what we did just about a month back. Didn't get too many, just short clips. You can see there's a lot of blood and fibrovascular tissue. The light is a little bright. Anyway. So you see, what we are trying to do is we've got to going to remove the attachment of this fibrovascular abnormal membrane, fibrovascular polyposite, FVP, from the disc outwards in a tangential, very tangential direction. You won't pull anteriorly at all. You've already strained it. Okay? And you're going to pull very slowly, steadily, very slowly, steadily, as each attachment or nail breaks. People will say, I use the scissor and all. Scissor is very cumbersome. Each nail you remove with the scissor. I don't think it's of much value. You want to do a CR surgery, you do it. In diabetic retinopathy, we get excellent results with this kind of a procedure. And this part I've seen in the last 6 months. And we get very good results. And even if a couple of hypogenic breaks may occur, which may be there in the audience, the AIOS may say, it's no problem, it can be easily treated. And then you do laser and still gas. Such a case is very well managed with gas, proper position. This is another patient who had also traction on the macula. He had a hyoid also, thickened hyoid. So what we did was, again, here we use the standard light. Okay, we removed the pre-macular hyoid first, blood. And we put a chandelier. We put a chandelier at 12, we can put it on the nasal side also. Chandelier is fourth hour, fourth. As everybody says, fourth. So again, increase vacuum. Start from the macula, take off the posterior hyoid as a whole. Once you take off the posterior hyoid, the entire fibrovascular complex comes off. And you're not just bits and pieces of neovascular tissue on the retina, segmentation, scissor cutting, all this is not for modern day DI study. Get the whole thing off smooth, the retina is healthy, normal. So this patient has a hyoid thickening and also some traction. What I did was, I did the surgery and then we went on with the macular lens and the IOCT guided. You see there's a little bit of epithelial membrane. So what we did was, we just removed this hyoid very atraumatically. I still feel the pinch peel technique is better than using any finesse loop or that loop or this loop. There's nothing better than using a pinch peel technique. It's very controllable. The minute you don't catch the right tissue, you'll take it off. If you use the finesse loop, it damages the nerve fiber. You keep doing like this. It's like massaging the nerve fiber, it's not done. So we find this works well. So in general, I think it's a game changer. I find it very useful. So these are take home messages, but this is just in brief. But there's a lot of the lecture by itself, I think, told you that there are a lot of new things which are coming in, new imaging guidelines are there. And how we have to manage, and how the surgical and the imaging management is there. So there are changes coming in diabetic retinopathy. My personal views and thoughts, I've told you in this day of World Diabetes Day, and I hope this will be useful refresher lecture for the entire AIOS. And thank you very much to the entire AIOS and the executive, especially to Professor Namrata Sharma and Professor Rajesh Sinha for inviting me to deliver this talk. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful talk. I think the way you explained, even many non-retina person will understand a lot of what you were talking. And it was a very nicely explained, diabetic retinopathy management. Now we have Dr. Anand Rajendran, who will be talking about management of diabetic macular edema, principles and paradigms. And once he does his presentation, then we can have the panel discussion.
So I'd like to thank AIOS for having me here, and it's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank Professor Namrata Sharma, Professor Rajesh Sinhal for putting this session together on this World Diabetes Day, and of course Professor Atul Kumar for spearheading this. I'm going to be talking to you about risk management of diabetic macular edema, basic principles and paradigms that we need to keep in mind. And just a word on pathogenesis of Professor Atul as well, covered that in fairly great detail. So it's basically diabetes and hyperglycemia, which is a driver for a bunch of complex biochemical and pathophysiological pathways through a number of, again, mechanisms and a bunch of cytokines and chemokines. As you see, there's a whole load of them. VEGF or vascular endothelial growth factor is the most critical one. And then there's alteration of blood retinal barrier, increased vascular permeability, leakage, and you have diabetic macular edema. Now, it's because there are these many factors that you also have diabetic macular edema being refractory to anti-VEGF very often. You don't see that level, that quantum of refractory choroidal neovascularization as you do with diabetic macular edema, because there's so many factors, and VEGF is just one player, but it is the major player. So the evolution, the management of DME has moved on from the laser photocoagulation erstwhile method that we had in the 80s to the turn of the millennium, where intravitreal steroids ushered in that entire era of pharmacotherapy, the turn of the century, to this current era of anti-VEGF therapy, which is represented largely by the anti-VEGF triumvirate, the bevacizumab or Avastin, ranibizumab or Lucentis, and efgartigimod or Eylea as we know it. The new player, brolucizumab, has been approved for AMD, neovascular AMD. It probably will have an impact in time to come on diabetic macular edema too. So the approach we're going to take is to look at the current basic principles that govern DME treatment, largely from the trials. That will tell us the factors that we need to assess, and then determine how we need to strike or act. So DME management, the critical guiding principles that we need to know and internalize from the trials that are there with us. First up, Resolve showed us that ranibizumab was the first anti-VEGF showed very high efficacy and as a modality of treatment for diabetic macular edema. So DRCF, specifically the protocol I, showed us a few things. Ranibizumab laser combination was better than laser alone or IVT and laser in combination. And when you looked at these combination arms, it was the deferred combination which was better than instituting prompt laser. This two-year equity plot clearly shows us A, that the combination arms were better than laser only and IVT and prompt laser. That deferring laser was not a bad idea. I showed an advantage later at year two also. And then pharmacotherapy, all the modalities, anti-VEGF as well as IVT is better than laser in immediate period as well as in the late period. So this equity advantage of deferred laser over prompt laser, which you see very clearly at 2 years, is also there at 3 years and at 5 years. And this advantage of deferring the laser is also seen in terms of reducing macular edema or thickness. Next, the trial showed us very clearly that early intense treatment, treating that macular edema aggressively first up, reduces treatment burden later, because the repetitive treatment is an issue with anti-VEGF treatment. And this slide shows us that both the combination arms, in the first year, there was a large number of injections, 8 and 9, but subsequently, that rate of retreatment dramatically drops, which seems to suggest to us that we need to, when you see diabetic macular edema, we shouldn't shy away. Early aggressive treatment to contain the disease is important, and then subsequently, it will surprise us that the number of retreatments drops down dramatically and significantly. And up to 43% of patients required no treatment than in year 3. Higher safety issues were noted for intravitreal transdermal steroids, which was the earlier gold standard, and in terms of elevated intraocular pressure, as well as cataractogenesis, with over half the patients needed cataract surgery in just 2 years. Rise and ride showed us something very important, that in untreated eyes, it's never too late to institute anti-VEGF treatment. Too often you see people often thinking that, patients had thickened macula for a very long period of time, it's not going to respond, and then we are a little shy of instituting aggressive anti-VEGF treatment. That's far from the truth. Chronicity is not a big deal. And this second and third year plot clearly shows us from rise and ride that first, the yellow and the orange line show the ranibizumab arms, which take off almost immediately, whereas the white line with scan treatment just hugs the baseline, hardly gets off the baseline. And the moment after 2 years, you can look at that period as being a 2 year holding period. After 2 years, the moment these patients were fed with ranibizumab, the graph starts moving up. And you see that with same trend with macular edema reduction. The moment these patients are given Lucentis or ranibizumab, the macula starts drying almost magically and almost catches up with the rangeon of arms which were instituted earlier. So it's never too late to start treating a patient with retinopathy with anti-VEGF. Restore, interestingly, showed the same thing, but with only laser-only analysis. Again, the same thing. It's never too late for anti-VEGF treatment. Secondly, it also showed that counterintuitively, adding laser didn't seem to reduce retinal retreatment rates, which we think laser, you know, the work of laser is to reduce the retreatment rate. Well, it really didn't do so in this study. So this acuity plot shows that, again, the retinal, pure retinal, as well as the combination arm, gets off applying self-pitch from the start, whereas the laser arm, again, barely gets off the floor. But the moment after 1 year, you start giving the blue plot, the blue those patients, you see it starts snaking up. And interesting, all magically, at the end of 3 years, it catches up with the ranibizumab laser combination arm. The corollary to this also is that it doesn't seem to make a difference whether you add that laser to ranibizumab at the start, yellow line, or after 1 year, which is the green line. At the end of 3 years, you end up at the same point. So again, to hone the fact that, you know, you need to add anti-VEGF to even laser eyes. This slide shows that there were no difference in retreatment rates in all the three groups. So adding laser didn't seem to reduce the retreatment rate. Then the board showed us high efficacy for bevacizumab. This study did the first set of trials that showed us high efficacy for aflibercept in diabetic macular edema. DRCLT protocol T, very talked about study when it came, caused a lot of furor, talked about extensively in various conferences. But at the end of 2 years, you got two clear messages coming from this trial. A, there was higher efficacy for both aflibercept and ranibizumab, vis-a-vis bevacizumab, for that subset of patients who had poor vision, meaning less than or equal to 20 by 50. Second message, bevacizumab optically reduces macular edema the least. Why do you say so? So this is the 2 year plot, equity plot, which shows that at the end of 2 years, aflibercept was better than ranibizumab, but that difference was not statistically significant. Both were definitively better than bevacizumab. And that was a statistical significant difference there. At the end of 1 year, if you note, the graph is actually between aflibercept and ranibizumab is a little wider, and there was a statistical significance at the end of 1 year. So those aflibercept became all pumped up. At the end of 2 years, the difference came down a bit, but it was still there. Macular edema reduction, you can see that both aflibercept and ranibizumab do much better than bevacizumab decidedly. These are the three dosing regimens which are out there, monthly dosing, PRN of pro, V, NAPA, which means criteria-based treatment and treatment external effects. So we know that monthly dosing is not practical, there's risk of infection, the number of injections, the huge economic burden, it's time consuming. But obviously it has to be the most efficacious of the anti-VEGF regimen. PRN dosing is basically anti-VEGF administered based on physician discretion and based on certain definitive equity and OCD criteria. Now the retail study was the first single masked RCT in DME. Of treatment extension. Treatment extension is a very popular regimen in the Western world. This looked at treatment extension ranibizumab versus treatment ranibizumab with laser versus treatment extension ranibizumab alone versus PRN ranibizumab. And it showed us that there was no real significant difference across the treatment groups at both the time points, 12 months and 24 months, and it was almost comparable to PRN to DME treatment. The Bevacizumab answered an important question at that time. It looked at the head-to-head comparison of Ozodex versus Bevacizumab, a large prospective study. Showed that at the end of 2 years, Bevacizumab did far better statistically than dexamethasone alone. But interestingly, if you look at that pseudophagic subset of patients, dexamethasone seemed to be almost as good as Bevacizumab. Whereas when you look at the central macular edema reduction plot, you see that dexamethasone is able to reduce macular edema much faster, it's a deep blue line, much faster and much more than bevacizumab first time. But at the end of 2 years, they end up at the same point. So if you want to get hold and control the macular edema quickly in a pseudophagic patient, dexamethasone does a good job. I mean the steroid implant overall. So now moving back a bit from the trials to what we need to do when a patient is in front of us. So these are the factors that we need to assess. We need to look at the clinical profile, the fundus picture, obesity, angiographic features, equity of the patient. We need also to look at the fellow eye status, the systemic profile. We need to rule out masquerading. It's important. We need to know the dosing history of the patient being subjected to, drug use, what is the dosing strategy, was it adequate, number of cases of injections. The patient factors in India is important, compliance, financial issues. And I've just divided this into two mitigating factors, which I feel I think RP degeneration, macular atrophy, thinning, subfoveal fibrosis, macular ischemia, poor vision leukemia, you know, less than equal to 2/60, loss of the diastole's integrity, and the chronic factors like outer tubulation is the drill. Dr. Atul has mentioned that. The surgical factors also need to be looked at on the OCD, irreversible leverage, knee and tubular macular fracture. If these are there, you would desist from a very aggressive injection, re-injection treatment regimen. But if you have encouraging factors like this, you know, pure clinging edema without all those, like seen in picture, with or without subretinal fluid, and suboptimal vision between region between 618 to 4560, you can consider more aggressive treatment regimen. So, examples being, you know, macular ischemia, subfoveal fibrosis, RHVNS in the fovea, outer retinal tubulations, macular atrophy, drill, surgical factors like retinal tracking, macular membranes. So, if you have a patient who, you know, the fellow eye also important, if you have the fellow eye have a good vision, you may want to desist from a very aggressive treatment regimen, but if it's one eye and this is the only eye who is dependent on, then you may pursue a more aggressive regimen. Glitazones, we know, are associated with diabetic macular edema. Nephropathy, hypertension, anemia can aggravate diabetic macular edema. You need to be watchful, because stroke, mitral infarction, and allergies. You need to importantly rule out macular disease, because as well as touched upon hypertension, mitral, and excellent retinal crisis. And this is a regimen that can be followed as a rule of thumb, you know, monthly antibiotic injections initially, and the patient is stable, use unchanged over 2 to 3 visits equity in OCT. Wait and extend. If you have those mitigating factors, then you can wait and extend follow-up up to 2 months. But if you have those encouraging factors, you can treat and inject and extend follow-up up to 2 months. If it's stable, you can extend follow-up up to 3 months. If it's not, you go back to treat and extend. It's simple rule of thumb. So again, dosing is inadequate or healthy, use that management once on the 2 or 3 injections or treat and extend. If the dosing is adequate and you have what you deem to be a refractory macular edema, you can switch it from Avastin. That's a common case, to Accentrix or vice versa. In the case of Avastin, refractory to that, no real change, and then benefited well with Accentrix. Reverse is also true, but less commonly. So all these studies are there. We show that, you know, ranibizumab and aflibercept have benefit patients refractory to refractory DME. Elderly pseudophakes, you can consider IVTA. All the decks, as Professor Atul also mentioned, the main USP would be in vitrectomized eye, as Boyer's study showed. The kinetics for positive is the only drug where the kinetics do not change once the eye is vitrectomized. It also showed that the MEAT study told us that dexamethasone 0.7 is useful in cases of refractory DME, but other modalities have been tried out. Pharmacocombination protocol U, DRCF showed us that adding dexamethasone to ranibizumab offered no real significant advantage in terms of equity improvement. Further advanced studies showed that, again, adding IVTA to Avastin also offered no real significant advantage. There are additional benefits of repetitive anti-VEGF therapy, largely with regarding DR progression, both seen both with ranibizumab and aflibercept. They've also shown that there is a slowing of the progression of retinal non-perfusion in DR. So diffuse DME, the combination, you can use that. IVTA can be used, as I mentioned, in pseudophake patients. If you're referring laser, you can do that. That would be better than doing it promptly. Laser, as a standalone, as Professor also mentioned, can be used. There is a role for that, especially in non-center involving DME. This is the place where laser definitely is there, so you don't have to start the machine. Surgical conditions are like intraretinal membrane and vitromacular attraction, and surgical position and tracking. And finally, you need to rule out the macular disease. Thank you, and we'd like to welcome all of you to our annual Retina Society meet.
Thank you, Dr. Rajendran. It was a wonderful overview on diabetic macular edema. Diabetic retinopathy is such a burning issue these days that a lot of activities are being done at the level of various institutions, RP centers, also doing under the guidance of Professor Atul Kumar. There are many institutions which are doing, I'm sure that Professor Tabay also must be doing, and there are many institutions that are active in, taking care of the strategies that should be devised in order to handle diabetic retinopathy. The All India Society is also doing a lot of activities for the screening of diabetic retinopathy, for managing diabetic retinopathy, for helping in creating awareness, for helping in preventing blindness due to diabetic retinopathy. And I request the General Secretary of AIOS, Professor Namita Sharma, to please give us a brief outline on what all activities AIOS is doing in this direction.
And this is a very brief presentation on what AIOS is doing for diabetic retinopathy. There's a pan-India diabetic retinopathy project which aims to fix the missing link. So what is being done is that the physicians are being targeted, and in the physician clinics, the cameras, the fundus cameras are kept so that you can screen the diabetic retinopathy patients. This has been done in various states, which include Jharkhand, West Bengal, as well as Chhattisgarh, and we plan to do it all over India. Then there are collaborations which are there with several of the NGOs which is being done, and collaboration with AIIMS also, with our affiliated societies like ECOIN are also doing diabetic retinopathy screening. And again, these are some of the pictures of the activities which have been taken, which have been, which we have taken, undertaken in various states like UP, like Maharashtra. This is again a PDP program which was launched in Maharashtra, then in Delhi, then even in West Bengal, and awareness camps of diabetic retinopathy in Bihar, even in the Northeast region, which is being targeted, and Assam, Guwahati, Shillong, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh. So we are trying to cover the entire country in this diabetic awareness program as well as the diabetic screening program. And the most important thing is that the screening is not at the level of the ophthalmologist center, but at the level of the physicians. So from there, we are getting the patient to the ophthalmic centers. So these are the PDV programs, again, the CMEs, which have been undertaken in various states and cities. And today is the World Diabetes Day, so no day which is better than better than today when we are having this. And now we will have the panel discussion over the talks which were done. And so over to Dr. Sarita Devi for the questions.
And the question is, the post-vitrectomy, how to manage the post-vitrectomy DME, the diabetic macular edema, which happens post-vitrectomy. Professor Atul Kumar.
DME, I think you can give anti-VEGF, same dose, or you can give steroids, both work. You don't have to reduce the dose or increase the dose, it's the same dose. The half-life goes down, the pharmacokinetics is such the measure will stay shorter. Fever will stay longer. But you can give both. Apply both, it works.
Yeah, I agree. I think, as I mentioned, the Boyer study showed clearly that this is one unique situation where Ozodex has a clear role over edge over all the other anti-VEGF or other pharmacotherapies. Because it won't elute out faster. The kinetics, the drug elution rate will remain the same. It's not dependent on the anti. Antivirals do work, and if a patient is able, it's not able to elute it because they have antivirals only, and it works, it will work. The only thing is, the 1 month period will go down. It will probably be a few days, it will probably be a week or so, that is where you need to see, where you'll see that the edema coming back. So it will work, but the edema will come back much faster, the drug will stay alive much for a very short period of time. With times and all, you'll have the crystals sedimenting. If the patient does the fake or the pseudophakic, you might have the migrating to the anterior chamber. But with the positives, it will probably stay there like a rock, and it'll probably do. So, but the thing is, the cost is an issue. That's
the thank you.
The same thing about the posterior capsule rupture or a big rent, then the orthodex implant may come into the issue. You can't eat it up. You got to viscoelastic express it. You can't vitrectomize it. So the fluid is there, the implant is going to move around very fast. There's no gel to hold it back. Anti-VEGF goes in, there's no, patient doesn't perceive anti-VEGF.
Thank you for the answers. I hope the answer to Dr. Namita Gupta is done. And now we have another question. What about infrared laser treatment for diabetic macular edema?
Infrared or subthreshold?
some threshold she must have met. Yes, there is a role, but we don't know what's the end point. And actually what's speaking is that you have a better alternative in anti-VEGF. According to the RCTs, you know, to compare the effect on that, usually what they have shown in the various studies is not so effective. Because it's at the RP level, it causes, doesn't cause destruction, but the effect on the DME is not so pronounced as what you would get in an anti-VEGF or a steroid. So CSR may be a good option for treating these subthreshold. Subthreshold is still on the way up. It's not taken up as such a way that it requires a RCT just now. It can be done.
Micropulse laser.
I think there is some role. There's been some talk about. There's been evidence also from the Western world and the European centers, especially Professor Eduardo Medina from Europe, thought about subthreshold micropulse yellow laser. That is IQ577 from IDX, and various other companies have also come up with that. There's shown some effect. We tried it a couple of centers. We tried it for diabetic macular edema. We haven't found it to be as effective, but there are many people who've shown very good results with that. That is an option that is there in your arsenal. It's something that can be considered. But and probably that's going to be talked about more than infrared, which was the question.
Okay, the next question is how to treat hard exudate plaques at the macula.
Very difficult to treat them. Probably give a steroid. That's the only way. It may dissolve it. Also reduce the, make sure the lipid levels are well controlled. Also the steroid implant, for the steroid implant or a transdermal injection may help. But antivirals don't help in hard exudate with the phobia. So poor prognosis, poor side.
Yes, very good.
So this is a case where maybe hyperlipidemia has to be controlled.
Correct. Metabolic control is the key.
So how soon can we see diabetic retinopathy in a juvenile case of diabetes? What is your experience about it?
Diabetic retinopathy can be seen earlier. It all depends on the duration of the diabetes. So, I mean, in the second decade, we've seen people with diabetic retinopathy. So that's definitely there.
Diabetic retinopathy starts usually after puberty. Puberty is around. Go up. Type 1 diabetes can really spurt out of aggressive PDR. And in fact, they're so severe they need a surgery to do because they have TRDs or secondary RRDs. So you need to do surgery because the laser also is not so effective. Type 1 diabetes. You will be on insulin.
So, as such, in your talk, also the duration and the diabetic control matters a lot. And because of the hormonal changes to puberty. Another similar question, changes in retina in diabetes usually appears after how many years after detection of diabetes? Again, a similar question in maybe type 2 diabetes.
Yeah, we start seeing that there's a curve for that. I mean, everything depends on the severity, duration, the metabolic control. So we start seeing it pretty well from 5 years onwards. Up there, it almost type 2 diabetes.
Okay. Very pertinent question. What is the management in a case of ischemic diabetic macular edema?
Ischemic diabetic macular edema is a tough nut to crack. Usually, visual gain is not much. You think it's steroid. Anti-VEGF is controversial. They say it may increase the ischemia. There are more reports which say increase the ischemia because there's a vasoconstrictive effect. Normally, VEGF are very good for health. They vasodilate. They also help in wound healing. And in the cardiac tissue, it vasodilates the coronary. So don't think VEGF is bad for health. It's these drug companies which keep on telling you, take anti-VEGF. VEGF is very good for health. So therefore, if you want to give anti-VEGF, it's not give so much that it is said that too over anti-VEGF giving also causes destruction, auto-apoptosis and the destruction of the RC and photoreceptor layer. You should only give it when and as and when required after the initial 3 loading doses. So what I'm trying to say is that if you've got ischemic macular edema, probably steroids are only alternate. As far as I can say, a short one online and answer.
Thank you. And this is mainly an answer to the question which was asked earlier. He says, I give infrared laser treatment to my patients. It gives very good results.
elaborate on this intraocular, because we know subthreshold, you know diode laser, we know argon green. You heard of
so this needs to be clarified.
This has not been heard by us in ophthalmology. This has to be clarified. Infrared fomentation we've heard of.
I think all the questions have been answered. Just a one-line answer to what is the best approach to treat a diabetic macular edema. A one-line answer from Dr. Anand.
Yeah, as the rising guide, as I mentioned, clearly showed us that, you know, even if it there they had, as I showed, you know, the control arm was 2 years of no treatment. And then after using anti-VEGF, the equity improved very clearly. Also, the macular edema, almost like a mirror image, improved. Even if the patient is dying, as long as we know the patient doesn't have all those mitigating factors, all those bad things that we talked about, the ischemia, bad heart exudates in the phobia, that is not there, then you definitely should try. Every patient should get the benefit of a good course of anti-VEGF treatment to first time.
So monthly anti-VEGF,
yeah.
Till the macula dries, that is all 4 months or 3 months,
yeah.
And then will you like to laser?
So laser, I mean, I would restrict you. If you see clear focal microaneurysms, you can go ahead, definitely. But initially, I think 3 anti-VEGF would be the best course of action.
And then treat and extend.
Yeah.
So there's another question, is there any treatment to arrest mild non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy to moderate non-proliferative? So mild to moderate, is there any way to arrest it? So metabolic control is to be done, which is the most important.
Hypertension, refer to cardiologist, refer to endocrinologist. Nothing else, follow up 6 months.
So not to forget about the systemic management, which is extremely important. And another question, one line could answer. What is the best treatment for poor responders to anti-VEGF? 20-40% in all these studies, they are poor responders. So how would you go about it?
Which anti-VEGF, strict steroids, control of diabetes, check the periphery with white field for any unlasered areas.
Is there any role of vitrectomy in chronic DME without any VMT?
It is a tough question, but it may be. If the myeloid gets thickened, the island gets abnormally thickened. So they say non-responding DME, there's anti-VEGF in the serums and all have not worked and the patient is incapacitated in the form of visual acuity disturbance. You can consider a removal of the posterior myeloid as well as removing the island. It increases the oxygenation of the macula and there's an aggressive fluid outward. So they say it helps. But this is the last probably the indication which we should consider. Usually there is a tractional DME. That is the one which should be benefited the maximum.
Thank you. So the next question is, what is the treatment of DME during pregnancy?
Control of that.
And you had suggested that laser would
hypertension.
Be the, laser could be the treatment in case there is a
DME, we won't laser.
Any microorganism which
so
is
so it can work. If it's constant involving, we may put a light laser burn. But we're not going to do angiography and we won't do any antibiotics. That's for sure.
So you would suggest that octa and mild
octa.
Laser?
Octa and mild laser if it's non-center involvement. With center involvement, we let it be. Ask the patient to get the best control of diabetes and hypertension possible in her setup.
The best NSAID to give for diabetic macular edema, is it nepofenac or some others?
Well, this is, I'm talking about in the talks with, DRCR, they had protocol E and protocol R, which showed that over a long period of time and over a large number of patients, topical NSAIDs really didn't make too much of a difference to those patients. So you could try it if you're a very anxious patient who's got 6'6 and metabolic control is good, then you may try, and it could be Nevanac. I would rather go with Nevanac. But if, on the other hand, you have a patient who has 6'6 and who has same level of macular edema, but who is poorly controlled. And the best thing is a very simple answer there is control your metabolic situation.
So another question, which is a burning question, is a cataract patient where, as you suggested, that 3 months before the cataract surgery, you should be treating the patient very aggressively, but the patient in India comes as a mature or hypermature cataract, you do not know what is happening behind. So what will you suggest after the cataract surgery, you look at the macula and you look at the diabetic retinopathy. So you, would you like to give an Ozurdex, Triamcinolone, or anti-VEGF on the table?
I wonder if we are. On the table is difficult. If I can see the retina and see the changes, I'll give it on the table.
So you will give
you on the table
the corticosteroids?
No, I'll give anti-VEGF.
Anti-VEGF.
Yes.
Action will take some time to happen.
Yeah, because the PDR also gets suppressed with the anti-VEGF better. The DME would be probably the same. So we don't have much data on the Ozurdex in PDR. We have data on the macrodema, ranibizumab will cover both. The DME and metoprolol S, they covered the PDR also. They even did eyes with PDR minus DME in protocol S. So we, if there is evidence, I'll give anti-VEGF in it.
I agree, because after two, definitely anti-VEGF would be safer, because God forbid, if you have an infection, you don't want steroids in time in the last 3 months.
The patient cannot afford, will you give PST in this cataract patient which you have operated?
I'll give intravitreal.
Intravitreal cancer alone?
PST has no value.
So that answers most of the questions. One more, if there are no further questions from the AIOS web site. So one more question, like what should be the pharmacotherapy? When should the pharmacotherapy be initiated if the vision is more than 6 by 12? Less than 6 by 12, everybody knows that this has to be treated. But what about vision is more than 6 by 12 and the OCT is showing some changes?
Some changes.
Which is keeping the visual acuity good.
Control of diabetes. Wait, observe, call back after two months, even monthly they can come. But get a strict control of diabetes and see again.
So no treatment if the vision is better than 6 by 12.
A total of 5.
This is where I think we need to distinguish between 6-12 in a DME patient and 6-12 in a choroidal neovascularization patient. 6-12 in a choroidal neovascularization patient is a potentially blind patient. DME patients will not go blind. It's 6-12. They can very well improve over a couple of months. And as Sir says, if you control your metabolic control well, this is all the manifestation of the diabetes in the body and diet. If you control that, the primary triggers, it should improve.
So systemic treatment is the main answer. Any role of anti-VEGFs in proliferative diabetic retinopathy? A lot of studies are going on, but what about your opinion about giving anti-VEGFs in proliferative diabetic retinopathy?
Very severe PDR, I feel a single shot may help to reduce the neovascularization, reduce the laser load. For laser, you have to do a lot. You can reduce the neovascularization and there's no TRD happening on the macula. Then a single shot of anti-VEGF, actually after a month later, the patient is much better from the clinical point of view. You can see the octa is much better. Yeah. And then you can put in laser.
There was a slide which you had showed that
yes.
There would be, you had given anti-VEGF and followed by laser and the
vision
had gone completely. Thank you. Are there any studies on the unmet needs in diabetic retinopathy patients? That's the question. Are there any studies on the unmet needs in diabetic retinopathy patients?
They need to get there. They have to be very educated. They should be educated. There should be health education as AIOS is doing. But they need to know that they should get a dilated fundus examination from an ophthalmologist.
So awareness and compliance. Awareness and compliance is a mainstay. And in which I think AIOS is also doing a lot of work, and not only for the patients but also for the physicians. So awareness and compliance for the physicians as well as for the diabetic patients. The next question is systemic methotrexate 10 milligram weekly for 3 to 4 weeks also gives a very good result in reduction of diabetic macular edema and also other forms of macular edema. What is your opinion?
I've never tried it, but it's basically an anti-inflammatory role. The steroids is very well covering. So I don't think we should go beyond steroids now. It's very dangerous. There's a side effect, systemic side effect also.
But
I don't advocate any immunosuppressive or DI.
It will be like
already, patients of diabetes are immunosuppressed. They are by themselves immunosuppressed. But then immunosuppressed them, they're going to end up with some secondary infections. Probably endophthalmitis during cataract surgery.
So, systemic corticosteroids, this is also not really indicated.
Not indicated.
A systemic methotrexate.
Oh, yeah, no. Absolutely not.
So if there are, there's another question coming up. So for chronic DME, another question I can just ask, for a chronic DME, would you like to start the patient with corticosteroids or anti-VEGF? Or first give a trial of anti-VEGF, then corticosteroids?
Yeah, I think we've answered that with protocol with the rise and ride trial, and protocol I also. In today's world, the first choice has to be anti-VEGF. Question is which anti-VEGF? That is a more pertinent question. And again, there you have protocol T answering that question also. In terms of equity thresholds, if equity is poorer, then you have aflibercept ranibizumab doing better than bevacizumab. But if equity is good, then the guidelines are that you can use bevacizumab or ranibizumab.
So the good vision criteria.
So that's the first answer question. It has to be anti.
So the good vision criteria is
6-12.
Another question, in PDR with TRD, not involving the macula, with DME, anti-VEGF versus steroids. Non-macula involving TRD with PDR.
Not involving the macula, give the...
Is but if you would like to give anti-VEGF or steroids?
First. Anti-VEGF. For the DME.
For the DME, you will
like
to give...
And also the universal blood center regress. And then either you plan for a surgery, it's not progressing, then you can put laser. It's protocol F doesn't talk. Of course, it's paid effort. Even laser will really help. So give an anti-VEGF injection and laser. And as and when PRN dosing of anti-VEGF.
So anti-VEGF and laser. Mm-hmm. And you have to keep a watch for increasing TRD.
Increasing TRD towards the macula.
Towards the macula. And in that case, a surgery could also be standby available. Again, the question, in PDR with TRD, not involving the macula, it was the same question repeated. So I think if there are no more questions, I can ask the Secretary and the Treasurer to wind up. Thank you, everybody. It has been a wonderful session with Dr. Anand and Professor Atul, telling us so much about the diabetic retinopathy on this special day.
So thank you so much. I think we would like to thank the speakers and the panelists, Dr. Anand Rajendran for coming from so far, for being with us here today on the World Diabetes Day. Professor Sabita Berry for again doing such a great panel discussion. And of course, Professor Atul Kumar, who has been so supportive and who has been so encouraging in all our endeavors, whether at AIOS or outside AIOS. And for allowing us to do this webinar at RP Center, and for so lucidly and comprehensively telling us all about diabetic retinopathy and answering the questions also, all of you for so well. So thank you so much. Until the next webinar. Thank you. Thank you so much.